algae. It's gross green goo that collects in still water and can possibly make our future greener too. Researchers are finding weird and unique ways to turn living algae into solar panels and hydrogen farms. So how exactly can algae do all this? And will they end up as a choice on our plate of renewables anytime soon? Let's take a look at the weird science behind living solar panels. I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. This video is brought to you by Incogni, but more on that later. As renewables continue to grow, more and more developments appear to sprout out of nowhere. Well, not exactly nowhere. This time it's algae and it's coming from a pond near you. It's been a while since we've checked in on the scummy stuff, and new research is revealing some surprising ways that we may be able to take advantage of it one day. Algae are pretty good at taking in sunlight and producing energy. That energy, as your middle school teacher will remind you, comes in a chemical form, usually glucose, not the electricity that we usually mean when we say energy on this channel. And yet, a team from Amrita University in India has developed a way of using common algae from a pond in their neighborhood to generate electricity from the sun. So how does it actually work? Well, hold on tight, because to explain that, we're going to have to go into some organic chemistry, a notoriously difficult discipline. I'm going to keep it very simple, do not worry. Put as simply as I can, photosynthesis is a chemical process where plants turn water and carbon dioxide into chemical energy. You almost certainly remember this, but did you know that electron manipulation plays a key role? Part of the photosynthesis process involves atomically flaying electrons away from water molecules. Now, this produces oxygen, which personally I'm a big fan of, but what happens to those electrons? Well, the photosynthesis process helps transfer them along a photosynthetic electron chain and produces nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide phosphate, or mercifully just NADPH. Now, this chemical is critical to managing anabolic reactions, and these reactions keep things alive. Again, big fan. Some electrons don't make it to the NADPH stage, and instead exit the cell in a phenomenon called exoelectrogenesis. Now we have free floating charge carriers with nothing to do and nowhere to go. If you're aware of the mechanics behind a solar panel, the light bulb above your head may be turning on right now. Just like an ordinary inorganic solar panel, if we apply some electrodes to this setup, we can collect those charged particles and turn them into usable electricity. And that's what the Amrita team did. They sandwiched their local algae between activated carbon-coated copper foil and a titanium dioxide-coated fluorine-doped tin oxide electrode. Now, this isn't the first biophotovoltaic device that's out there, or BPV, though it might be the first one where living microalgae are generating electricity. Now, while the field is still very new, Amrita's version does seem to be the best performing one so far. The previous high scoring algae, Chlorella vulgaris, came from a 2018 experiment. It had a photocurrent density of 0.0654 milliamps per square centimeter and an open circuit voltage of 0.127 volts. Amrita used Pythophora achieved a photocurrent density of 1.25 milliamps per square centimeter and open circuit voltage of about 0.58 volts. In both cases, this is a huge step forward. But how does it compare with inorganic solar tech? Well, current gen commercial cells have an open circuit voltage of around 0.5 or 0.6 volts. So the algae is really pulling its weight here. On the other hand, modern PVs boast a photocurrent density of around 20 to 40 milliamps per square centimeter. So the algae still has a very long way to go. I should also note that the vulgaris device and the Pythophora device had different setups and were composed of different materials, so this isn't an apples to apples comparison. It's not like the species of algae was the sole source of the improved voltage and density. They didn't just pluck the algal version of Pikachu from a pond or something. Though the fact that the Amrita researchers just fished some algae out of the nearest pond instead of seeking out or cultivating the best species for the job and still got amazing results is actually one of my favorite parts about this study. If any old clump of algae can do this, there's most likely room for optimization and advancement. But before getting into the viability and remaining challenges of the green goo's applications, there's another important challenge that we need to talk about, and that's protecting your online privacy with today's sponsor, Incogni. I've mentioned this before, but I signed up for a newsletter from a small online retailer, and after I did, I saw a major increase in the number of promotional emails I was receiving from companies I've never heard of. Now, that happened because that company sold my information to a data broker. Sometimes they sell your info to some pretty shady people, or they can fall victim to data breaches that leak your data to scammers. Now, I'm sure you've experienced it too, and Incogni can help you with this. We have the right to request that data brokers delete our information, but it takes a lot of time and effort. I signed up for Incogni, gave them the legal right to work on my behalf, and then just sat back and relaxed. You'll see updates in your account for which data brokers they've sent legal requests to, and which ones have complied. It couldn't be easier. I've been letting Incogni stay on top of this for me for a very long time now, and I'm really happy with the results. If you want to take back some of the control around who has access to your personal information, give Incogni a try. Take your personal data back with Incogni. Use code UNDECIDED at the link below and get 60% off an annual plan. Thanks to Incogni and to all of you for supporting the channel. So back to the challenges with algae. As cool as the tech is, the green goo doesn't have the green light just yet. Heck, it's not even really lab viable at the moment. It's just one set of experiments after all, so I'm looking forward to seeing how other researchers replicate and improve on it. Even so, there are hurdles that will need to be cleared. The efficiency is, of course, low, and at least for now, algae's lifespan can't compare to the 20 years sported by an average commercial solar panel. This is one of those,
we'll cross that bridge when we come to it.
But scalability is also going to be an issue. Each cell is going to need its own attention and upkeep if the algae is to survive for a meaningful amount of time. As one of the researchers and authors of the paper explained to PV Magazine, the scalability and efficiency hurdles are made all the harder by the necessity of a liquid reservoir in the cells. You gotta have a place for the algae to chill and photosynthesize without the water parameters or temperature getting out of hand. As the researcher put it, this is something that needs to be overcome before it can be widely adopted as a viable energy source. Even considering these potential issues, what if we can work out those kinks? It opens the door to some truly green and very sustainable solar panels. If we allow ourselves a really optimistic outlook for just a moment, then larger scale solar panels using algae instead of precious metals would mean less destructive mining to get those materials. For now though, this remains just a potential theoretical application. Of course, solar power isn't the only kind of green energy, and there's more ways than one to skin an alga. Never had to refer to algae in the singular tense before, and it feels weird. Anyway, researchers from the University of Cordoba in Spain are working on another neat use for algae, and that's farming hydrogen. And we've explored hydrogen many times before, and for good reason. It can be a zero emissions fuel depending on how it's produced. When used in a fuel cell, the only waste product it leaves behind is water. Its scalability is one of the reasons many people are excited about pairing hydrogen with intermittent renewables for energy storage. Plus, hydrogen is everywhere. It puts the H in H2O. It makes up most of the mass of the billions of stars in the universe, and it's present in all living things. Unfortunately, it's also difficult or energy intensive to remove hydrogen from its hidey holes. Even though it's quite literally the most common element in the universe, it's actually pretty hard to collect and energy intensive to separate from other substances.
Ironic.
Also, hydrogen atoms are quite small, even for atoms, adding an additional challenge to collecting and storing them. Now, this is where you're probably saying, sure, Matt, I remember a couple of paragraphs ago, there's probably some weirdo species of algae that makes hydrogen. And you're partially correct. The real answer is so much stranger. Microalgae, in this case, Chlamydomonas reinhardti, does produce hydrogen, but not a lot of it, unless it's stressed out, like me trying to pronounce all these algae names. So how do we stress algae? Well, not with mortgage payments or car problems, but by depriving it of nutrients like sulfur or nitrogen. As you can imagine, freaking the algae out doesn't lead to long-lasting colonies. Earlier experiments maxed out at just 10 to 15 days. To make things even trickier, algae produce oxygen, just like other photosynthesizers. However, too much oxygen in the algae's environment can deactivate the hydrogen production process. Algae isn't the only way to grow hydrogen. Some species of bacteria can do it too. Better yet, bacteria can eat the oxygen that the algae produces, making sure it stays in a low oxygen and highly productive state. This has led some researchers to mix algal and bacterial cultures together. Usually this results in the bacteria taking over, which doesn't work out very well. That's when researchers from the University of Cordoba in Spain found that they had accidentally contaminated an algae culture with bacteria. Their hopes weren't high. They let it ride though and found that the contaminated cultures were actually producing more hydrogen than the monocultures. The end result was up to 13.5 times more hydrogen. Naturally, this warranted further study. In addition to the expected Bacillus cereus bacteria, they also found two brand new species, Microbacterium forte and Stephatrophomonas goyi. I'm absolutely butchering these names, so I apologize. As it turns out, the algae and bacteria were actually helping each other grow. How? Well, this is another oversimplification of some organic chemistry, so please bear with me, but the forte bacteria were helping the algae produce more hydrogen, while the other two bacteria were providing the acidic acid the algae needs to grow. They were also eating the oxygen so the algae could keep producing hydrogen. Meanwhile, the algae was producing all the bacteria with the vitamins that they needed to grow. With all the parameters in balance and everyone working together, the culture wasn't just producing more hydrogen than its rivals, it was also longer lasting too. pumping out hydrogen for 25 days instead of just 2 or 3. It was a good balance. The algae was stressed out enough to produce a lot of hydrogen, but not so stressed it stopped growing. And theoretically, using algae, you could clean wastewater or cultivate biomass. It's a win-win, win-win-win. There are a lot of possible paths forward. Unlike some other hydrogen-producing setups, this culture was productive under all light intensities that they tried. This bodes well for those future real-world applications where light isn't going to be lab perfect. The combo culture also handled a wide variety of temperatures, from 73 degrees Fahrenheit or 23 degrees Celsius, up to 86 degrees Fahrenheit or 30 degrees Celsius. And before you laugh, that's pretty tough for algae. Neda Fahimi, a co-author from the research, points out that these features mean that we can couple a biohydrogen farm with other applications. Wastewater is particularly interesting as the algae can feed on the gunk in wastewater and clean it up. Combining hydrogen farming with these other kinds of facilities can theoretically help us achieve industrial-scale hydrogen production. Plus, the biomass that grows in this kind of setup can also be recovered and used for fertilizer, fuel, biomaterials, and bioremediation. Normally, hydrogen-producing algae are too stressed to produce much biomass, so this is interesting for the circular economy. The paper also suggests that there's many possible ways to further refine this tech. Mutant strains of algae cultivated or engineered for hydrogen production and longevity is one way forward. There's also room for further optimization when it comes to the lighting. The fact that this particular cocktail of algae and bacteria yielded such a huge boost in both hydrogen generation and longevity begs the question, are there other better bacteria and algae out there? Could there be even more effective symbiotic combos waiting to be discovered? Only time and more research will tell. And while this is all very promising, I have to rain on the parade a bit. Much like the algae solar panels from earlier, biohydrogen tech is still very immature. Though the Cordoba team made a huge leap in hydrogen production, we're still talking about very tiny amounts of it. Even a few hundred milliliters is still a huge haul. Scaling it up might be the solution, but we'd have to improve a lot of other components before we can even talk about how and if this scales. For instance, collecting biohydrogen is still inefficient. These facilities will likely require a lot of real estate, which is expensive. While the Cordoba team's co-consortium was super long-lasting, we're still measuring algal longevity in the term of days. There's a lot more research to be done before we know if this will be viable, and we're still years and years away from even speculating on possible commercial prospects. So where does this leave us? Well, I want to stress again that algal tech, whether solar panels or hydrogen farms, is still far away from becoming a reality. These first steps are very exciting, but the technology is not ready to deploy quite yet. As we mentioned earlier, there's a lot of possible paths forward. Perhaps we can genetically engineer algae that's a super photosynthesizer, makes a ton of hydrogen, is tougher or lasts longer. Perhaps there's another bacteria that will boost our algae's performance, just waiting to be accidentally discovered. Maybe the perfect strain of algae is, at this very moment, collecting in a pond near you. Even though the wait will likely be a long one and the future is not clear, I'm definitely interested to see how algae tech continues to grow from here. And speaking of renewable tech, I'm going to be at the Everything Electric Canada show in Vancouver between September 6th and the 8th. I'll be moderating panels on topics like everything you need to know about heat pumps, the impacts of wind, solar, and storage, induction cooking, as well as being on a panel about home energy hacks. It's a fantastic show about, well, everything electric. So batteries, recycling, solar, and much, much more. You can even take test rides in a lot of really cool electric vehicles. If you're interested in going, use my code EEMAT20 to get 20% off your show tickets. I'll have a link in the description, and if you do go, be sure to say hi if you see me. But what do you think? Do you think technology based in algae has room to grow? Jump in the comments and let me know, and be sure to listen to my follow-up podcast, Still to Be Determined, where we'll keep this conversation going. Thanks again to all my patrons for your continued support, and I'll see you in the next one.